this year, I get to introduce a client and an inspiring friend. Our next speaker has taken the country by storm and has given women the ability and access to great-looking hair. Because let's face it, when your hair looks good, you feel good, right, ladies? Allie had an amazing business idea, which has turned into a small empire. The Dry Bar Salons can be found in almost every major city throughout the U.S. and rapidly growing. She had a vision to provide great service, amazing experience, and exceptional products that have become an obsession to women throughout the country, including myself. With that, I'd like to introduce Allie Webb, the founder of Dry Bar.
What a great day, right? I feel like I've been so inspired by listening to everybody speak. I feel like there's after listening to everybody, I'm like, damn, I should put more slides in my presentation, because there's so much I want to tell you guys and there's so much I want to talk about. And I, you know, this is my first time here, so I didn't totally know what I was getting into. And I also want to say to the girl last night who's going to work for Nike, if that doesn't work out, come work for me. She was amazing. And it's really, you know, when I was asked to speak at this conference, what really hooked me was that I would be able to be in front of students. And I feel like my story, which you'll hear, is very unconventional. And I was definitely a late bloomer. And I struggled a lot after high school and figuring out college and what to do with my life. So I feel like I love to talk to other people and help students. You know, it's okay if you don't have it all figured out. I feel very strongly that everything happens for a reason and things work out the way they're supposed to. So without further ado, I want to kind of introduce, if you don't know what Dry Bar is and you've never been there, but by the way, how many women in the audience have been to a Dry Bar? Oh, we have to get those numbers up. Well, that's good because I have a video, but I didn't spend $10,000 on mine, Sam Fox, wherever you are. By the way, it was a really good video, and the quinoa pancakes are my favorite dish ever. I love True Foods. But I have a video to kind of give you an idea, especially for those who haven't been there to Dry Bar, what it's about, and also there's a lot of men in the audience who probably have no idea what this concept is and why it works. So this will shed a little light on that. So here you go.
Tonight, what's the dealio? I love when it's all too much. 5 a.m., turn the radio up. Where's the rock and roll? Party crasher, penny snatcher. Call me up if you a gangster. Don't be fancy, just get dancy. Why so serious? So raise your glass if you are. Right on the spot. It's so on right now.
It's so fucking on right now.
Party crasher, penny snatcher. Call me up if you a gangster. Don't be fancy, just get dancy. Why so serious?
Have it. What's interesting about that video is, as I will explain to you, my husband and my brother are my business partners, and my husband does all the creative, and I actually have not seen that version. There's some new stuff in there, so that was really fun for me to see as well. But anyways, for anybody who's curious about why Drybar got started and how it really came to be, it was first and foremost personal necessity. I've naturally curly hair that I've struggled with my whole life. I'm sure there's women out there that can relate. I was that struggling teenager in high school just trying to figure out how to blow out my own hair. And even as a little girl, I struggled with my naturally curly hair. So this is me as a young girl. And you can see that this is my hair. And I always was obsessed with having straight hair. Well, this is me when I was much younger, and that's my mom blow drying my hair, which, by the way, she's not a hairstylist, and I love her, but she never did a really great job. But it was even back then, as a little girl, like 6, 7, 8 years old, I used to beg my mom to blow out my hair because I couldn't articulate it back then, but I felt better when I had a blowout, and I just had more confidence. Of course, I didn't realize it then, but I was always asking for blowouts. Otherwise, my hair was crazy and frizzy, and I just hated it. So I always knew that this was my passion, but like probably many of you out there, it took me a long time to realize that I could actually make a career out of this. And after high school, I really fumbled around trying to figure out what to do. I went to Florida State for a year. That wasn't my thing. And I came back and went to fashion marketing school, and I worked in fashion for a while. And my parents actually had their own business, as they used to refer to it as the smata business. So some of you out there probably know what that means. It was an older ladies Missy clothing store, and they opened a bunch in Boca Raton, Florida. And me and my brother used to work at those stores and sweep the floors and do anything they asked us to do. But it was actually, I didn't realize it at the time, but it was really the foundation for building really incredible customer service within me and my brother. So after years of kind of struggling, I realized that I wanted to go to beauty school and pursue my true passion. And like some of the other speakers I've heard today, my parents were not really excited about that decision, but nonetheless supported me, and off I went to beauty school and became a hairstylist. So this is a really old, grainy picture, but oddly, one of the only ones I can find from my haircutting days. And I've basically for the last 10, well, more like 20 years have been doing hair, and I always loved it. It really was my passion, and I learned so much in the beauty world and working in salons. And you all know from going to salons are fun, and the stylists are creative and energetic, and it's just a fun place to be, and I really always was drawn to that environment. But there are certainly things that I didn't like about it, which I've now had the opportunity to change within my own company. But fast forward 2 years later, I met my husband in New York City, got married, had some babies, and became a stay-at-home mom. And I felt like the luckiest woman in the world. My husband had a good job, he worked in advertising, and I felt so fortunate and lucky and grateful to be able to stay home with my two little kids, this is them much younger, they're so cute. But now they're 7 and 10, and when they were about, I would say 4 and 2, or almost, my older son was almost 5, I just really got the itch to get back out there and do something for myself. And I didn't know what it was. I didn't want to go back into a traditional salon, and I wanted to work for myself. I just didn't know what that was. And then one day I was sitting around with my best friend who had also had a little baby, and I was like, maybe I should start, and this is a true story, I remember this conversation like it was yesterday, I said, maybe I should start a mobile blow-dry business because I can do blowouts in my sleep, and then I can get away from my kids for a couple hours. And she was like, that's a great idea, can you do mine tonight? So I posted a little, on this little website, this mommy blog in LA. I was very entrenched in the whole mommy community. I was living in LA at the time. And I started a little business called Straight at Home. So, speaking of starting businesses and marketing and some of the things that we've talked about today, my husband, who is in advertising for years and years, told me, if you create a cute little card and we'll give you a one-page website that's really cute, people will go to the website and then they'll call you. And that was probably my first lesson in marketing, because I was like, all right, not thinking anybody was going to call. But sure enough, people started calling me as soon as I posted that ad. And I was, I basically was running around town blow drying all these all these women, all basically my mommy friends, and it was perfect. I remember being so happy at the time because I was able to get out of the house and I was able to make a little extra cash. I was only charging $40 to go to Women's Home, which is very inexpensive, as some of you might know, and it was a great little business. I don't think I actually made any money because it gas in LA, but nonetheless, it was great for me personally to do something for myself and to see this little business grow. And what happened very quickly, within a year, I had way too much demand and not enough time. And that's when I realized, that's really when the light bulb went off for me, that there's no place for women to get blowouts. There was two bad choices. I mean, there was places, but they weren't great places. There was either their traditional high-end salon where they would have to pay $60, $70, $80, $100 for a blowout, or there was a discount chain where the experience was off and a kid was getting their hair cut and it was bad lighting, and it was just like there was these two bad choices, and that's what I was hearing from my clients all the time, that there wasn't a good option. So that's when it hit me that I should open a brick and mortar and I should have them come to me instead of me going to them. So I went to my brother in 2010. We launched our first dry bar in Brentwood, California. At the time, I was living in Santa Monica and I thought I could run this one little shop and I could pick up my kids from school and it would be the perfect thing for me, and I'd make a nice little living and that would be that. We never imagined that this shop and this concept would turn into what it has today. And it's from the very beginning, we completely underestimated the demand, and we realized literally on that very first day that we had tapped into this market and we had touched women, and literally, and that we were onto something. And I mean, I will never forget the first day, the tears and like, oh my God, we did this, and we couldn't, you know, we were all just blown away, no pun intended, by the success and by how much women wanted this. And at the right price, women would come often in droves, and they did. And so it was a very exciting day, and it's been a very exciting journey. This is my husband in the black and my brother in the white.
Whoa.
Something funky just, okay. Okay, and then my sister-in-law is on the left. So it was really just the four of us starting out this business. And of course, as you can see, I'm surrounded by bald men, which, weird. But anyways, it's really ironic that they are my two best friends and they are my business partners, and we are the luckiest people alive because we all get to work together and we truly, truly love it. We don't think of it as work. We feel incredibly lucky to be doing what we're doing. And yeah, we knew on that first day that we were really onto something special and that our lives were about to change significantly. My brother was running a real estate marketing company at the time, and my husband had his big fancy advertising job, and it was just me and Sarah in that first shop. We did not leave the shop for 6 months. I was there every single day from open to close, because I was just so obsessed with this was my baby, and I wanted it to be perfect, and I wanted it to be right. And so as time's gone on, here's another shot of me and my brother. Also, that's the very early days. And as I mentioned before, my parents really instilled in us this, that the customer is always right, and I've heard it a lot mentioned today about the experience in customer service, and we learned that so early on, and I feel so lucky that my parents gave us that. And as we grow, now we have 42 locations. We do over 100,000 blowouts a month, and we're pretty busy. We have over 3,000 stylists working for us. It's an incredibly big business. I posted this slide because we had our first ever, which we probably need to do those more, our big manager conference, and this is basically our whole executive team. And we have a girl that came to us from Apple, John Hefner, who was the CEO of OPI. So we have all these big fancy people now helping us run the company, but they really share the vision of Drybar and are really, we're so incredibly lucky to have them. I feel like it's important to point out that when you own your own business, it's really hard to start entrusting other people to run it, and it's your baby and you want things done a certain way. And that's something that I've certainly struggled with, but something that is really important to grow. And we are on track to open 15 more stores this year. Like I said, we're doing over 100,000 blowouts a month, and we are very excited. We're in DC, as you can see, with our giant buttercup. You know, another thing that I wanted to talk about was, you know, which again has been mentioned a lot in this conference, is the people and the stylist. And you know, that was an opening just a couple months ago at our Alpharetta store in Atlanta. And you know, it's really about the people. And I've always felt like, especially having worked in the salon industry as long as I have, that you know, it can be a very cutthroat environment. And with Drybar, I wanted this environment to feel like very much a family business, and I wanted to always have that mom and pop. I want people to come in, and they know who, when women come in, we know their name, and I think that's a huge part of it. And I think that starts with your employees and making sure that your employees are really happy and feel really satisfied. So, why does Drybar work? Why have we had so much success? Something Rebecca mentioned, and something that I feel really passionately about, is that we are not just selling blowouts, we're selling the happiness and confidence that you get from a good blowout. And I don't think, I wasn't saying that 5 years ago because I didn't understand it. And until we started opening more and more shops, you know, I started noticing this transformation that happens to women and the visual difference in their demeanor when they come in our shop and their hair's in a bun and they're bitchy and they're like not having it. And then, When you turn them around for the big reveal, which is, if you've been in our shops, you know we have mirrors that are actually behind you because you're watching a chick flick, and I've always felt like nobody looks good with wet hair, and staring at yourself in the mirror is like all wrong. So the mirrors are actually behind you when you're getting your blowout, and when you're done, you're turned around for the big reveal. And that's a really magical moment. And if any of you guys out there go sit in one of our shops, watch it, you'll see it over and over again. These women just light up, and you see this like happiness kind of wash all over them, and there's a pep in their step. And I swear to God, I've witnessed women like literally bouncing to the front. And they're so happy, and there's this amazing confidence. And I don't know that I realized that when we first started, I kind of thought I was opening probably the most vain business ever, but then realized very quickly that, you know, it's not. It's really about, you know, the way we make people feel, and it's so much more important than how they look. It's really how they feel, and that's, you know, and that's something that I'm so incredibly proud of. I feel like, I think I said it to somebody today, that we're changing the world one blowout at a time, and I really do believe that. I have women who come up to me and tell me that they feel better after they leave Drybar than a therapy session. That they makes them feel that good. So don't underestimate the power of good hair and a blowout. So the next kind of area I want to talk to you guys about is our 10 core values. And these are values that we thought long and hard on, and we talked to everybody in our company about, because we wanted these 10 core values to really encapsulate how we operate our company, how we treat our people, how we treat our clients, how we treat each other. And so I have another video, also didn't cost $10,000, to show you, that is it's a little funny and silly, but it's something that we, almost all our employees watch. And every time I go to a new store opening and meet new employees, they all always refer to this video, and this is the video that got them in the door. Hi, everyone. It's hard to believe that there are over 1,000 of us at Drybar across the country now. As we continue to grow, it's super important that we maintain the amazing culture and magic that makes Drybar so special. So I'm really excited to introduce to you the heart and soul of Drybar. Our 10 core values and beliefs that we all aspire to live by, here they are. Number one, it's the experience. The single most important part of the Drybar experience is the way we make people feel. We're committed to making our clients feel like $1 million each and every time. Number two, it's not just blowouts we're selling. It's the confidence and happiness that come from a great blowout.
Number three, be yourself. Tattoos, piercings, quirky laugh and all, it's what makes you special and interesting. As Gaga says, I'm on the right track, baby. I was born this way.
Number four, embrace the power of random acts of kindness. Selfless acts of kindness can make someone's moment, day, or week.
This blowout's on us. Just cause.
It feels good to make people feel good.
Especially when they're not expecting it.
Number five, have fun. Laugh, smile, dance, look beautiful. Life's too short to be someplace lame.
Number six, always be growing. There's a tremendous opportunity ahead for all of us.
you commit to helping us grow, and we'll do the same for you.
She knows what she's talking about.
Number 7, nothing is sexier than honesty and humility. Arrogance and cockiness are gross.
Actions speak louder than words.
Number 8, make a difference. Have an opinion, a point of view. Have the courage to stand up and make a difference.
Mike.
Number 9,
pretty is pretty does. Be a good person. Care about people. You're only as pretty on the outside as you are on the inside.
Number 10, we are family. Dry Bar was started by a family, and you're part of our family.
Number 10.
You get shot? Did you forget your line?
Number 2, it's not.
I can't wait to see that part.
Ready?
I don't really like acting.
You're great.
Oh, I know. Forgot the whole person.
It's okay.
Make a difference.
And I don't like audiences. Yeah.
Hi, everyone. There are over 1,000 Dry Bars.
Like, stand up.
HR.
Wait, is this part? Just be yourself.
We are family.
We are family.
Number 9 is alive.
Come on, Dylan.
Number 10.
Doesn't that look like a fun place to work? As you saw, have fun is one of our big core values, and I really believe that. You gotta have fun, and that's where I speak to the students out there, is that, God, you know, we work so much, and, you know, I feel like I spend my life at Dry Bar and working, and there's so much work to do, and there's so much to do. But when you're passionate about what you're doing and you really love it, it doesn't feel like work. And I know that sounds cliche, but it's so true. And if there's one thing that you get from me today, is like, as I beg you to do something that makes you really happy. Maybe it's not what your parents want you to do, but something that you really truly want to pursue. But that there's also hard work that goes along with that. Here's just another slide of in our corporate office. We have a wall of all of our managers, so that everybody in our office, even people who don't interact with the managers as much as others, just kind of know who everybody is. And one of the last things, or I'm getting close, is customer service, which I've touched on a couple times, and social media. I'm super, super, super passionate about social media. And online shopping, by the way, that's been a big theme. I buy everything online. Sorry, Jerry, but you know, it's the social media world and how much you can connect with your clients and people online is so incredibly powerful. And I feel like that has really helped grow our business so much. And I personally oversee all our social media. I saw a tweet from someone out here today, The Talented Blonde, which, yeah, thank you for that tweet, it was very sweet. I mean, I stay so connected to what people are saying and how people feel, because if you know, it's this great medium to learn what your clients feel and what they want. And I feel like that is something that is really powerful. And although I believe social media, Instagram, Twitter, are all mostly very positive, and I'm very grateful for that. There's definitely negative stuff that comes through there too, and we, whether it's Yelp or Twitter or Instagram, we respond super fast to any issues that come in, good or bad. And here's just an example of some tweets that people have tweeted when what I'm not showing you is what came before these tweets, but you know what this does show you is how quickly we respond and how much it means to our clients to get that instant response. You know, I think because customer service was so embedded in me as a kid, you know, my brother and I have written a lot of letters and sent a lot of emails to CEOs of companies who you never hear back from them. And for me, if you send me an email and something went wrong, I'm gonna get back to you, or someone on my team is gonna get back to you, probably me, probably my brother if you send it to him. And we feel so passionately about, you know, really being available for our clients. And of course, as we grow, that gets harder and harder, and we only have 42 stores, not 700 and however many. So, you know, in another 5 years, I might feel differently about that, but I sure don't wanna lose that passion for our customers and making them feel like they're, you know, they really have a voice and we're listening and we care. This whole slide is on our conference room wall in our office, and really just, again, just talks about how much people love to shout it from the rooftops when they love your company and when they love your brand. And that is, and they are, you know, your clients are your biggest ambassadors, and, you know, we try to really treat them the best that we can. So I wanted to just show you a giant buttercup, which I showed you for a second before, but again, I feel like Drybar was so meant to be, and my brother and my husband and I all have such different strengths in this business, and my husband is really the branding genius of this company and deserves so much credit. One day he dreamt up this idea of having a giant buttercup drive around the city before we opened a shop, which we are all like, what? But, you know, he made it come to life, and we built this giant buttercup, and now every time almost every time, she's very expensive, but every time we open a store, giant buttercup is driving around the city. So you can imagine when you walk out of your house and you see giant buttercup, you know, you know we're there and you know we're in town. Another kind of fun thing is our coasters. These are our gift certificates, which you're laughing because it says lucky bitch. But I'll tell you, you know, that's the beauty of owning your own business, is that you can do whatever you want. And and I love, that might be my single favorite thing about owning my own business, is that, you know, we can do, you know, stuff like this. And there will be, if you had got a focus group together, they would probably tell you people will be very offended by this because it says lucky bitch, but I'll tell you, this is our number one selling coaster. We sell this coaster more than any other ones. We have ones that say someone loves you, and this one's on us, and they're all really cute, but nothing quite like lucky bitch. So there's I know, it's crazy. There's something really powerful about this one, and people really love it. So, you know, it really is a testament to being able to push boundaries and not always have to follow the rules. So lastly, one of the newer kind of endeavors in our business is the launch of our product line, and we launched it about 2 years ago. And I never imagined, I mean, I feel so incredibly grateful for the success Drybar has had, and would have never imagined that I could develop a product line that would be equally successful. And if my big brother were standing here right now, he would tell you that he definitely didn't think I could. But, you know, I've been doing hair for 20 years, and I feel like I've tried every single hair product out there, and I had vast knowledge of so many different hair products. And when we opened our first couple of stores, it dawned on me that, you know, I was using a mishmash of products and cherry-picking products from other companies, and it just, you know, it just didn't feel consistent, and I didn't like the way it felt in the shop, and I didn't like having to use all these different products, and I kind of got on this kick to develop my own product line. But if you've ever tried to develop a product line, it's not easy, and I, you know, got a lot of doors slammed in my face, and it was hard to get it started. It wasn't until about 3 years ago when we were raising more money to grow the business, and we took money from a private equity firm, Castanea, and attached to Castanea was Janet Gerwich. And for those of you who don't know who she is, she's the founder and former CEO of Laura Mercier Cosmetics. So she knew everybody, and she opened a lot of doors and helped me get this product line off the ground. And it's been this amazing journey to get the product line going and to develop a full line of products and tools, which is so near and dear to my heart and has been such a labor of love for me. We launched it about 2 years ago. Sephora graciously helped us, and they really helped us quite a bit. I know there's some Sephora in the house today, and Sephora has been an incredible partner and helped us really along the way as we were getting started, and then did a test for 75 of their stores of our products, and it did really, really well. So now we're in the process of expanding to over 300 doors. So we're very excited about the product, and it's quickly becoming just as big of a part of the business as as blowouts. So lastly, I'll leave you with, you know, again, going back to the having fun and just making sure that you're, you know, that you're at, that you, wherever you end up going in your journey, that you're somewhere that you love. And like one of our core values says, life is too short to be someplace lame. Thank you. Questions? Oh, I think she has one.
I have one.
Hi.
Hi, Allie.
Hi.
I'm Sandra from PetSmart, and I love your brand and the whole concept. And my question to you is, with the partnership with Sephora, do you think there's room or any plans in the future to have open stores next to them? And the reason that I ask is my experience has been that I always go from a blowout to either MAC or Sephora to get the makeup application. Mm-hmm. So it would kind of just do the whole makeover experience together. So do you know if there's any, do you have any of those plans in the future?
Not specifically, although I totally understand the need. And, you know, a question that I get a lot too is, you know, why don't you do any other services like makeup or something in your shops, which I totally understand, you know, the question and wanting to get more, you know, we're busy and we want to get everything done at the same time. For us, we feel very strongly about sticking to one thing and doing it well. But yeah, so to your point, opening next to a Sephora or somebody that can do makeup is certainly something that we actually try to do. And a lot of our stores, since the beginning, you know, we are always trying to, whenever we look for real estate, it's always there. There's, you know, I always want there to be a nail salon and a Starbucks and, you know, and a Whole Foods and maybe a True Foods and all the places that, you know, women frequent, whether they're going to lunch and going shopping and doing all those things. And actually in our West Hollywood, in a couple of our stores now, there's a concept called Blushington, which also does makeup, and they're kind of opening up everywhere we go. So, yeah, I mean, I don't think you're alone in that request, and I think that niche market of doing just makeup or just blowouts or just lashes or whatever it is becoming much bigger. So I think you'll start to see a lot of clustering of those businesses together. Hi. Okay.
I'll start this over. I'm Annie from Nike, by the way.
Oh.
How do you feel like you
Sorry
stay...
for trying to steal your money.
How do you feel relevant of staying relevant within a specialty niche? So in Oregon, we've seen a lot of different blowout companies. And since you just do blowouts, how do you feel that you stay relevant and up with the trends?
Well, it's funny because people have always said when we started this business and still to this day, like, do you think this is a trend? Blowouts are a trend, which I wholeheartedly do not think they're a trend. I feel like, you know, blowouts have been around since forever. We just created a much better space, experience, and environment to do them in. And I think in order to keep relevant is that we, like I touched on a little bit, like there's so much, we take so much customer service and feedback so to heart. And if you've been to Dry Bar, after you come in, you get an ad and you leave and pay, we send you an email that personally for me, practically begging you to tell us what you thought, you know, good, bad, we want to know, which also helps keep people away from Yelp. And so we're constantly paying attention to all that feedback and making sure that we're giving people what they want. To a certain extent, I also don't think that you generally listen to the public. I think you have to, you kind of have to carve your own path, if you will. And I feel like, I think that we've had a lot of success staying very true to the one thing that we do, whereas I have seen a lot of our competitors, personally, I feel like it's kind of the kiss of death once they start as a blowout bar, but then they add makeup and they add lashes and they add all these other things. And to me, that's a signal that clearly they're not getting enough blowout business, so they're trying to supplement, which I get. And listen, I mean, I'm sure for some people that works, but being a hairdresser and I oversee all the training of our stylists, and let me tell you, it takes so much time and money and energy to train these stylists. Even stylists who've been doing hair for 10 years, when they come into Dry Bar, we kind of have to break them down and reteach them how to do that, like, red carpet ready kind of look. So it's so much work and so much attention to detail, to I believe, for us to stay at the top of our game, that I think we try to stay really focused, if that answers your question. Anybody else? Hi. How do I feel about GlamSquad.com? I've never been asked that publicly. I'll tell you this. We have, good question, you provoker, you. So,
I have three daughters and two regulars, so I know it all.
Where do your daughters live?
I live in Miami, and I have one in New York.
Okay. Oh, well, thank her for me. Yep, she gets it. So the thing is, first of all, since we started Drybar, we've always had a service called Dry on the Fly, which is basically like we come to you. It's always been a little bit of an afterthought because we've all always felt like the experience is in the shop. And again, for those of you who haven't been in and you saw some videos, it's really, really fun. It's a bar, you're sitting, you're watching a chick flick, you're having a glass of champagne, you probably run into three of your friends. Like, it's a really fun place to be. And so we've always really focused on the in-shop experience. However, we realize that, especially in New York, we realize that women, sometimes they're just too busy to come in, or frankly, we have 8 shops in New York and we cannot build them fast enough there. They're always booked and we can't always accommodate everybody. So that dry on the fly service has become more and more important. And we are actually relaunching our dry on the fly app very soon. And it's basically like, it will be like the Uber of blowouts. Like, you'll see little buttercups where you see cars now. It's a very similar concept. So, you know, did we do that because of Glam Squad? No, we've always had that. You know, I think what Glam Squad does is great. And I think that there's enough kind of women for all of us. So, you know, I totally get what they're doing and I see why they did it and I think it makes sense. But we own the market share of stylists in New York City, so we'll see what happens. Yeah, bring them on. Is that it? Oh, yeah. Oh, hi.
Hello, I'm Sarah Halzak from the Washington Post. I was wondering if you could just talk a little bit about who the most common customer is for you. Is this a beauty junkie who comes in once a week and loves getting her hair done? Is this someone who's going to a wedding or going on a date? Who's your customer and how do you market with that in mind?
Women with hair. It's such the truth. No, but we have a lot of data, which I'm so not into data, but all the people in my company are very into it, and we have a new head of marketing, and she's all over that stuff and the statistics that we've seen. If she were here giving a presentation, there'd be a lot more slides and a lot more charts. But I can tell you that, you know, we have a pretty high subset of women who come in twice a week and don't wash their hair anymore. And those are my favorites. They, you know, those women are coming in all the time. And then we have, you know, probably a bigger subset of women who are coming in for events and they have a wedding to go to, a bar mitzvah or something big that they are going to. And, you know, and then there's the kind of the outliers, and then there's the ladies who lunch and the stay-at-home moms who, you know, are coming in on a Monday afternoon and, you know, just because they have a date with their husband that night. That's why I made the joke, women with hair, because it really does fit into everybody's life in some way, shape, or form. And I think the big kind of game changer for us and for Drybar was that, you know, we made this behavior, getting a blowout, which is what felt like, you know, something that's way indulgent. You know, we turned it into an affordable luxury that everybody could do. And I think that once, you know, there's so many women out there, so many women I've talked to who never had a blowout, never even heard of a blowout, who didn't have the crazy curly hair growing up that I did, and never even thought about it. But once they go in Drybar and they come out and they feel like $1 million and they feel like they can conquer the world, then they're like, okay, I'm gonna make this part of my weekly budget or my monthly budget to come in because I know how great I'm gonna feel after I come in. So, like I said, changing the world one blowout at a time. Good? Thank you guys so much.